In the middle of the 1st century AD, Rome controlled the lion's share of Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa's sun-baked coast. A sophisticated mail system and network of durable roads helped unite Rome's far-flung provinces. From them, the empire extracted wealth through trade and taxation. All roads, it was said, led to the empire's city-state, Rome, where its governing body, the Senate, administered justice and law. One newly created seat of power reigned above the Senate and set the violent course of first century European history. These powerful men were like gods, the Roman emperors. In 41 AD, Rome's third emperor, the unpredictable and insane Caligula, was stabbed to death by his own bodyguards to wide public approval. His successor, however, dampened Rome's salubrious mood. He was Claudius, Caligula's club-footed uncle, a stutterer long thought to be retarded. Ridicule from the Senate and general doubt about his abilities marked Claudius's first year as emperor. To silence his critics and earn respect key to his survival, Claudius turned to the tried and true mechanism of war. The prey he chose wasn't even on the official map. It was a near mythical region across an alien sea, said to be rich in pearls, minerals, and livestock. According to the science of the day, the large, mysterious island of Britain should not even have existed. From its drum-beating natives, Claudius and his generals expected no real resistance. After all, for 50 years, the empire had seen no rival in strength among the nations of the world. Yet in the Celtic tribes of Britain, Rome was about to discover a very major irritant. Britain in the 1st century AD was a patchwork of tribal kingdoms, broadly identified as the Celts. The Celts originally migrated to the island from Central Europe in the 7th and 8th centuries BC, leaving behind marauding tribes who campaigned widely and violently over the continent. The warlike Celts sacked Rome itself more than 400 years before Claudius's reign. In Britain, the Celts forged a hierarchical society in which warriors, priests, and bards lorded over property-owning freemen and slaves. Within kingdoms, aristocrats and warriors paid tribute of coin or property to tribal kings, who in turn paid tribute to overkings or suffered a punishment of death. Among themselves, the Celt kings fought incessantly. Fierce pride and the warrior ethic made up the heart of their spiritual and social belief. No doubt, Claudius heard the rumor that the bloodthirsty Celts collected the severed heads of foes to garner their enemies' strength. This rumor was true. Yet in the 1st century AD, the agrarian Celts were far more advanced than other barbarian cultures of Europe, with sufficient wealth to support a thriving class of craftsmen and artists. Accomplished ironsmiths, they manufactured a variety of durable weapons for their soldiers. The nearest thing the tribes had to a professional fighting force were chariot warriors who came from the aristocracy. The two-horsed British war chariot was built for speed. Each chariot had a crew of two, the warrior and his driver. The charioteers first attacked by hurling javelins, then dismounting and engaging the enemy on foot. The driver waited a short distance off to spirit his master away in case he was wounded or forced to retreat. A step down in rank from the chariot warriors were cavalry armed with javelins and swords. Below them came the bulk of the Celt fighting force, an infantry made up of farmers. Most of these men fought on foot in their family or tribal groups, using a spear, javelin, and a heavy slashing sword if they had one. The Celts' favorite weapon was a sling, which hurled round pebbles and specially cast slingshot, shaped like tiny footballs. Slingshot generally inflicted more harm than the arrows of the period. Roman surgeons developed these instruments to remove slingshot from the bodies of soldiers. Significantly, armor among Celt warriors was rare. Most Britons made do with a round shield and the magical protection bestowed by blue patterns painted and tattooed on their bodies. Lack of armor left Celt charioteers, cavalry, and foot soldiers sorely unequipped to face an aggressive armored infantry. Such an infantry was the very essence of the Roman army about to invade their shores. In the spring of 43 AD, four Roman legions and 20,000 auxiliary troops gathered on the northern coast of Gaul, now France, for the invasion of Britain. They comprised more than 40,000 soldiers, including 7,000 cavalry. Here, in one place, was the most efficient and professional fighting force the world had ever seen. The backbone of Claudius's army were legions made up of professional soldiers, Roman citizens who'd signed up for a 25-year hitch. These veterans drilled rigorously all day, every day, even through the winter. Each was expected to master any weapon that might fall into his hands and wield it under any circumstances, including in water and on horseback. In contrast to the Britons, Roman legionnaires were armored with a heavy helmet and plated lorica or body armor. They also carried a large shield or scutum. The infantrymen's main weapons were two pila, or heavy javelins, and a short stabbing sword called a gladius. The infantry's first battle-proven tactic was to hurl the javelin at close range, then draw the gladius and run at the shaken enemy. The method was developed to destroy close ranks of pikemen, but it would prove very effective against the Britons' chariots and sword-wielding infantry. In addition, the Romans used other battle formations totally alien to less sophisticated opponents. One formation was the wedge, designed to pierce an opposing line. The Romans then attacked their enemy from the sides and the rear. Another formation was the testudo, or tortoise. With their overlapping shields as cover, the formation could charge through missile fire and protect themselves when besieging a fortress wall. The smallest unit in a legion was the contubernium, or tent party, of eight men. On the march, these men shared a leather tent and a mule to carry it. Legionnaires also carried their own equipment and cooking gear. 10 contubernia made up a century, which was commanded by a centurion, a soldier of high standing, who's paid 5 times a soldier's rate. Each century had its own flag or signifier. The smallest tactical unit was a cohort, made up of 6 centuries, or about 480 men. A senior centurion commanded a cohort, which again had its own flag. In 43 AD, a legion contained 5,000 to 6,000 men and about 120 cavalry. They bore an eagle as their emblem or standard. More than once in Roman history, a soldier turned the tide of battle by carrying the sacred eagle into the fray. Accompanying the valuable legions were cohorts of auxiliary infantry and cavalry. These auxiliary troops consisted of men recruited from Roman provinces and sometimes captured armies. Their function was to act as light troops and screen the legionnaires from ambush and surprise attack. The auxiliary were equipped similarly, but more cheaply than the legions. After 25 years of hazardous service to the empire, members of this expendable corps could look forward to Roman citizenship, if they survived. At every level, Roman soldiers learned to fight as units, not for personal glory and heroism. Fierce discipline was enforced by their officers, but the soldiers feared more than any enemy. The opposite was true of the Briton Celts, whose undisciplined ranks valued individual valor above all else. In the bloody maelstrom of feuding Celtic kings, one high-born warrior rose above the rest to lead the confederacy of southern tribes against the gathering Roman storm. His name was Caroticus, and he would prove to be twice the enemy Rome had bargained for. The Roman invasion of Britain began with an unmitigated disaster, a mutiny in the Roman legions. According to the historian Dio Cassius, the legions were afraid of venturing off the coast of Gaul and campaigning outside of the inhabited world, as they called it. Emperor Claudius's private secretary, Narcissus, a former slave, arrived from Rome and shamed the legions into submission with appeals to the god Saturn. The invasion was on. The Roman warships sailed in three separate divisions. The major force made for Richborough, while a diversionary force landed at Dover. About the third, little is known. Yet evidence of forts exists today at Richborough and Dover, and a point to the west, Lympne. Archaeologists presume that the third force landed here. Remarkably, the landing was uncontested. Caratacus may have thought the Romans posed an empty threat after having learned of the mutiny in Gaul. But now, the Romans were indisputably here, and the Celt leader had to make up for lost time. Caratacus and other prominent Celt leaders assembled their armies at the River Medway and prepared to make a stand. The Roman invasionary force, led by General Plautius, was already on the move. Batavian auxiliary units, specially trained to ford rivers in full armor, crossed effortlessly and attacked. The Britons were stunned. Then the auxiliaries began killing their chariot horses instead of the riders, a disturbing tactic the Brits had never seen. In the confusion, the future Emperor Vespasian, in command of the 2nd Augusta Legion, forded the river upstream and took the Britons unawares on their flank. The Wild Celts' first contact with a real army looked like a rout. As reinforcements poured in for both sides, fierce fighting ensued. Gradually, the legions brought more and more soldiers across the river, forcing the Britons to retreat. But rallied by Caratacus himself, they only fell back to the next defensible river line, the north bank of the Thames. Again, the remarkable Batavians swam across. Again, another Roman force secured a crossing upriver. Britons caught between these Roman pincers were cut down in great numbers. But now the Romans suffered a staggering loss. Pursued by auxiliary troops, the Britons fled into a swamp. The auxiliaries followed, and hopelessly bogged down, came under an ambush of arrow and sling fire. They were slaughtered by the hundreds. Nevertheless, Caratacus retreated once more, realizing from what he'd seen that he could not defeat the Romans in a set-piece battle on equal footing. Radically different strategies were needed, and his 9-year career as a guerrilla warfare commander commenced. With the defeat of the lowland tribes imminent, General Plautius summoned Emperor Claudius so that he might claim credit for conquering Britain. The triumph was wildly premature. The campaign that followed was the sort of vainglorious circus the entire succession of Roman emperors is now famous for. By sea, road, and river, Claudius hurried to the isle, bringing along reinforcements, which included a number of elephants, the first ever to visit the fog-shrouded country. Inscriptions on triumphal arches in Rome recorded that 11 Celt kings were defeated in battle by the emperor during the 16 days he stayed in Britain. But in fact, Claudius's stunning success owed to the professionalism of the Roman legions. They'd proven they could prevail under even the worst commander. Meanwhile, a true commander, General Vespasian, began chalking up legitimate victories against the remaining free tribes through the south and west. According to his biographer, Vespasian fought 30 battles in Britain, subjugated 2 tribes, and captured 30 Celt forts. The future emperor's joint land-sea campaign must have occurred with lightning speed. Remnants of Celt hill forts indicate that their construction was interrupted. Excavated skeletons bear the mark of the Romans' grim handiwork. Some skulls were punctured by lances, others split by swords. One skeleton was found to have a bolt from a Roman catapult still embedded in its spine 19 centuries later. Following an artillery barrage of bolts and flaming missiles, the Roman artillery would be concentrated at certain points to allow the legionnaires, probably in testudo formations, to fight their way in. There, the individual valor of the British warriors would prove no match for the rain of javelins and the fierce charge of the Roman regulars. By 47 AD, 4 years after the invasion began, the frontier zone of the Roman province of Britain had been established, a band running from the River Humber through the southern coast. But then the Roman situation in Britain took a turn for the worse. A mysterious Celt leader began launching attacks on the tribes friendly to Rome. In the brutal wilderness of Wales, he engaged the Romans themselves in hilly and wooded terrain, making devastating hit-and-run attacks. The leader was Caruticus. With the support of Wales' remaining free tribes, Caruticus re-emerged in 47 AD, as a hardened guerrilla commander. Historians assume in the intervening years he was an active fighter, garnering support from his most influential allies, the Celt class of holy men called the Druids. Above all other enemies, the Romans hated and feared the Druids most. These nature priests practiced human sacrifice and divination from the entrails of their victims. They held council with Celt nobility and steadfastly opposed Roman rule. In Caruticus, they saw their last hope for survival and the last hope for the Celt culture itself. Ostorius, Roman Britain's new governor, fought the new rebel threat by disarming all tribes within the province. This prevented Caruticus from getting armed help from sympathizers in Rome's expanding zone of influence. In 50 AD, the Roman commander turned his legions against villages in southern Wales, ordering them burned and looted without mercy. With his people crying pitifully for deliverance, Caruticus decided it was time to make a stand. With concerted attacks, he moved the theater of war to mid Wales. Then, choosing as good a defensive position as he could find, he decided to risk a head-on battle. The Roman historian Tacitus described the strength of Caruticus's position with these words. He selected a site where numerous factors helped him and impeded us. On one side were steep hills. Stones were piled into a kind of rampart. And at his front was a river without easy crossings. The defenses were strongly manned. Both sides were spoiling for the fight. Years of pent-up rage motivated the rebel army. As for the Romans, they were tired of cat-and-mouse skirmishing in the boggy wastelands of Wales. Ostorius himself ordered the attack. The 20th Augusta Legion crossed the river under a rain of stones from the British slingers. Forming dozens of testudo formations, they pulled down the rough stonework. Once through this barrier, the Romans' superior equipment and training helped them make short work of the defenders. The Britons were driven to the highest point within the fortress, where they were killed or captured. Among those taken prisoner were Caruticus's wife, daughter, and brother. Caruticus himself was captured a few days later, betrayed by a tribal leader named Carimandua, who coveted his power. Along with his family, the now famous rebel commander was sent to Rome, where a public spectacle was made of his long-awaited defeat and probable execution. But remarkably, Claudius allowed the rebel leader to address him. Humiliation is my lot, he told the emperor, and glory yours. I had horses, men, arms, wealth. Are you surprised I am sorry to lose them? If you want to rule the world, does it follow that everyone else welcomes enslavement? If I had surrendered without a blow, neither my downfall nor your triumph would have become famous. So impressed was Claudius with the eloquence and bearing of his foe that he pardoned Caroticus and his family. With that, the rebel chieftain left the stage of history a free man. In Britain, Rome's network of conquering forts and sturdy roads ultimately penetrated the frontiers of Scotland. But the empire's changing fortunes in Europe prohibited further expansion. By 400, Roman Britain no longer existed at all. However, Christianity, brought by Roman soldiers, continued to thrive among Celts and new Saxon immigrants, who ultimately drove the Romans away. In the former province, Roman education and law revolutionized the island's prehistoric society and guided England into civilization's mainstream.
Stay with TLC for Battles That Changed the World, looking back on the Viking invasions of Great Britain and Britain's desperate attempts to buy off her conquerors.